always a sign of blessing. So we're so thankful for all children of God, and that's going to play into the sermon at the end of the sermon. My dear friends in Christ, grace, mercy, and peace to you this day from God our Father, Jesus the Son, and God the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Saturday, September 14th, is a festival day in the church, but it doesn't fall on a Sunday. The Sunday before is an appropriate day to lift up that festival. So September 14th, throughout the church, is called Holy Cross Day. And you may have noticed we sang a great hymn of faith, Lift High the Cross, as our processional hymn. And I believe at the end of the service we're going to sing When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. So it is a very beautiful thing to lift up today in music and in scripture. So there's four really important things to know that you can impress your family and friends with about Holy Cross Day. First is that Saint Helena, she's a really significant figure in early Christianity. She is the mother of Constantine the Great, the Roman Emperor. So she is from the late 200s to the mid 300s. She actually lived 80 years, which is a good long life for back then, or even for today. So Saint Helena, after her son became emperor, she converted to Christianity. She publicly proclaimed her faith. And because of that, and because of a vision that Constantine had before a big battle that he won, where God asked him to put the sign of the cross on his soldiers' shields, Constantine ended the persecution of Christians in the Roman Empire. So Helena is a really significant woman of faith, and she is known as someone who found something that's called the true cross. So what happened is she went to Jerusalem, and they were doing excavation work around what was thought to be the site of Calvary and the Holy Sepulchre, the tomb of Christ. And as the construction crews were doing that excavation work, they found a cross that was well preserved. And if you look up Helena this afternoon on your phone, tablet, computer, quite often you'll see images of Helena carrying a large cross. So the cross is very significant in the life of Helena and in the life of her son. That's the second part, second thing that's important about Holy Cross Day. He was not a Christian, and after his mother became a Christian, he not only called for an end to persecution of Christians, the early Christians, but also he built, to honor his mother's faith, he built a church in churches, I'm sorry, in Jerusalem, one at the site of Calvary and one at the site of the burial of Jesus. And I know if you've been to Jerusalem, I have not, but if you've been there, there is a church called Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And so that still exists today. The third thing about Holy Cross Day is that 300 years later, in 629, the Holy Cross, the true cross, appeared again after being stolen. Was stolen and was unable to be seen by anyone for a couple hundred years. But then it was found again. And so this was a significant day in the life of the church. And the most important thing about Holy Cross Day, besides the three historical ties, is that you and I, and all those who've come before us and all who will come after us, we know that the cross is the instrument of our salvation. By the time we get to Luke 14, Jesus has quite a large following. Luke says that in the opening verse today of the gospel, that Jesus had large crowds following him. And this is a cross-centered gospel. So all of these people that are following him, far more than the 12 disciples, they're attracted to Jesus for a variety of reasons. And Jesus turns and tells them about the cost of discipleship. And the cost of discipleship, he says, is two things. Carry your cross and follow me. Carry your cross and follow me throughout. And as long as we put Jesus first, as long as he is that foundation, that rock-solid foundation in our lives, when we carry the cross, we follow him faithfully, nothing is going to break or shake that foundation. Other foundations will come and go, but Jesus, his cross, they are the true foundation of every disciple's life. My guess is that after that day, many in that large crowd that followed Jesus stopped following Jesus because the cost of discipleship was too high, too worrisome, too much of a burden. And a lot of those people abandoned Jesus and went back to their lives. I want to lift up to you today 7 Christ-centered, cross-centered disciples who followed Jesus no matter what happened in life. And because they did, they were blessed. So the first is Mary Magdalene. She was a good friend of Jesus, and by accounts of Scripture, she was someone who had some wealth. She is known as the woman who anointed the feet of Jesus with the costly perfume that cost 1 year's of wages. She was a dedicated follower of Jesus, and she faced scorn and ridicule and hatred for her faith, but she never gave up. And she was blessed to be the first one there when Jesus was resurrected, to become the first proclaimer of the resurrection. Martha, Mary, and Lazarus of Bethany, they are sisters and brother, and they are also those people who had a lot of blessings in life. But all those blessings became secondary when they knew and loved and supported Jesus in his ministry. Lazarus is the one who died and who Jesus rose back to life. And in the Gospel of John, after the death and resurrection of Lazarus, people want to kill Lazarus because he is a sign of God's miraculous power at work. And thankfully, that never happens. So we're thankful for Mary Magdalene, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus of Bethany. We're also thankful for someone that a lot of women in our church know about. Someone has two names, Tabitha and Dorcas. So Tabitha lived in a place called Joppa, and Tabitha didn't know Jesus personally, but she knew him through her faith community. And she had so much love in her heart that she made clothes for orphans and widows. And when she died, everyone in her town was so sad, so filled with grief. And Peter was in the town, and they prayed to God, and Peter raised her from the dead. And Tabitha immediately continued her ministry of making clothing, of providing for poor orphans and widows. The sixth person, Christ-centered person I'm going to lift up, is Francis of Assisi. He is from the late 1100s, early 1200s. Francis was someone who was wealthy. He was the son of a wealthy textile merchant, and by all accounts, Francis went out and lived the life, if you know what I mean. He saw the world, and he spent a lot of his parents' money, and he had no intention of living for anyone beside himself. But then one day, he had a conversion experience, and he realized that Christ was the only one who could save him, not his wealth, not his possessions. And he went to the center of his town, and he gave his parents back everything that he had, including the clothes off his back. And he became a monk, a good servant of God the rest of his life, and is known as the patron saint of creation and of animals. So we're very thankful for Francis. And the last person, the last Christ-centered person I want to lift up for you today as a great example of faith is Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He was a Lutheran pastor and theologian. He was someone who fought very, very heartily against the Nazi movement in Germany. with his fellow confessing church pastors. And he had the opportunity, as a brilliant theologian, he taught at a place called Union Theological Seminary in New York City at the beginning of the wartime. And he could have stayed there in safety while everything was falling apart in Germany and in Europe. But instead, he felt the call to go back. And he gave up all of his safety and his comforts here to go back and fight the good fight of faith and to carry his cross, and ended up being killed less than a week before his concentration camp was liberated, April 9th. All seven of these people had blessings in life, but the greatest blessing for them was carrying their cross and following Jesus. On the day of our baptism, we receive a wonderful blessing at the font that goes like this: Child of God, you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. What that means is that you are of great value to God as his child, and that God has laid the foundation for you, for your life, through water, word, and spirit at the font, and those promises go with you throughout life. So to end today, what we're going to do is we're going to have a congregational participation blessing. If you'll take these two fingers, either hand, left hand, right hand, put them on your forehead, and when I say the blessing, feel free to make the sign of the cross on your forehead, as was made upon you, whether it's recently or a long time ago, as a remembrance of how much God loves you and how much Jesus is the foundation of your life. Child of God, you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, beautiful Lord Jesus, constantly active Holy Spirit, we thank you for the blessing of Jesus and his cross, and for the blessing of being your disciples. Lead and guide us graciously each day with your love and your peace and your mercy. Speak through us as we live for you and for the world around us. We pray it in your name, Lord. Amen.